morning. I don't know if you've noticed the poinsettia, the Christmas flower in the middle of our Easter array here in front of the altar. We had this lone poinsettia that has lasted since Christmas. And when we were decorating for Easter, we thought, why not? Let's put it here in the midst of the lilies and daffodils and azaleas and hyacinths. Partly thinking that, well, maybe our CNE Catholics, who were with us last Sunday at Easter, might take notice of it and feel more comfortable since that's what they saw when they were here last time. It got me to thinking about bringing together, connecting these two feasts of Christmas and Easter, and I recalled an argument that I had many years ago when I was an obnoxious little fifth grader with Sister Ruth, who was our religion teacher in fifth grade. And she claimed in class one day that the resurrection is the supreme feast of the church year. And I argued with her. I said, Sister, no, it has to be Christmas, because if Jesus wasn't born, then all of the other feasts would never have happened. So first is first. That was my peanut brain logic as a fifth grader. I've learned a few things since fifth grade. Certainly how all things are connected, how everything is related, how both feasts are celebrations of God's incredible love for us. The birth of a child, our birth into eternal life, the journey from the wood of the manger to the wood of the cross and beyond, from the womb to the tomb and beyond. All feet are expressing love as the motivation and the origin. God's outpouring of love for us. And clearly, the resurrection that we celebrate in this Easter season has become the most powerful force in the world. The resurrection is not just an historic event. It is and was a spiritual earthquake, a tsunami of God's grace. And in the Easter season, we encounter in the gospel reading the eyewitnesses to the resurrection, the original apostles, their fear and hesitancy at first to believe, but then how the Spirit of God rushed in upon them through the power of Christ's resurrection and changed them and began to change the world as it flowed out from Jerusalem to every end of the earth. We hear in the Acts of the Apostles reading how the power of the resurrection and the power of God's Spirit touched many as they became believers and followers of Jesus. Through the first 300 years of the church, we see how the power of the resurrection defeated the work that the Roman Empire could throw at these early believers through the witness of the martyrs in their persecution. And from there we see, again, the power of the resurrection flowing out through the whole chronicle of the world and now taking residence in us. The most powerful force in the world is ours, who have been baptized into the death and resurrection of Jesus. And the resurrection comes to each of us as a promise and as a mission. The promise is so clearly expressed many times in the Gospels. We look at the very end of the Gospel of Matthew, when Jesus, before he ascends into heaven, sends his disciples out and says, go make disciples of all the nations, baptize them, teach them to carry out everything I have commanded you, and the promise, know that I am with you all to the end of the world. We also hear that promise beautifully expressed in the 14th chapter of John. This is the Last Supper discourse. So the last teaching that Jesus is giving to his intimate friends, his apostles before he accomplishes his death and resurrection. And he says to them, do not ever let your heart be fearful or troubled. You have faith in God. Have faith also in me. He goes on to tell them, in my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I was going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again to take you with me, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, he told them, you know the way. And Thomas, the doubtful one in today's story, again says to him, hold on a second. We don't know where you're going. We don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? Maybe one of the only times in Scripture that a man actually asks for direction. We know Moses never did. It took him 40 years to find the promised land. And Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. That's how you make the journey to the Father. Through me, he says, the way, the truth, and the life. So we have the promise of the resurrection. And we have that also as a task. To keep that promise, Jesus becomes our way, our truth, and our life. He becomes the center of it all. He becomes what aligns everything in our lives, what aligns all of our priorities throughout life. He's the way, the path that we walk, the truth that we cling to and that we proclaim. The life that flows through us in love and service of others. Our way, our truth, and our life. We keep the promise of the resurrection. But it also comes to us as a mission. And I think Jesus taught us something very significant about that mission and about resurrection in particular, not long before his own. You find it in the 11th chapter of John's Gospel, when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. And if you recall that scene, he asked those who were there with him to move the stone away from the tomb of Lazarus. And he called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. Lazarus came out, bound from head to toe in burial wrappings. And then Jesus said to those who were there present with him, unbind him and let him go free. That's our mission. That's the mission of resurrection. To unbind each other and let each other go free. How do we bind us? By our judgment, our prejudices, our selfish expectations, our apathy or indifference. How do we let others go free? Through extending that life of Christ that is in us. Compassion, forgiveness, upholding dignity and respect of all. Extending the love of Christ to everyone we encounter on the journey. We unbind each other and let each other go free. My prayer in the weeks ahead as we celebrate this Easter season for all of us is that Jesus' way and truth and life will so deepen within us that we will proclaim the promise of the resurrection with our lives and live this mission.